Now, we would like to commence the Ministerial Roundtable. I would like to introduce Dr. Cosmas Zavazava of the ITU. As a moderator of this Ministerial Roundtable, Dr. Zavazava, please have the floor.
Thank you very much, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is with pleasure that we sit here and commence the roundtable, which is the Ministerial Roundtable. I will just introduce to you the format of the roundtable. This is not a speaker's panel. This is a discussant panel. We are going to give opportunities to the ministers to share their perspectives, particularly to share their vision. Also to exchange information with regards to the practices in their own respective countries. And then we can try to draw lessons as a result. You have heard from the opening speeches that the Sustainable Development Goals for the next 15 years are going to touch on things that relate to disaster risk reduction, and we have to measure in order for us to take appropriate measures. You are going to look at health issues. You are going to look at climate change and the impact. You are going to look at food security, poverty reduction and eradication if possible, environmental protection, and many other such interesting issues. And we want to know what is the catalytic role of ICTs. So our aim is to demystify technology. We want to remove the mask and see the human face. What is it that we can do with the technology? And before we proceed, and before I introduce the panelists, I would like to say to you, we are going to watch just a very short video, 3 minutes, which is going to set the stage and capture the great work that ITU and the membership are doing across the world. So please enjoy it.
ICTs, or information and communication technologies, are essential for the achievement of the UN 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development.
People everywhere can reap the benefits of connectivity. Let us empower individuals with these transformative technologies so that they can advocate and innovate for our common future.
Digital financial services lift people out of poverty. Not everyone has a bank account, but many have mobile phones.
As mobile digital technologies spread to even the poorest and most remote regions of the world, we have an opportunity to reach this underserved population and bring it into the global economy with expanded access to savings accounts, lines of credit, and other financial services.
ICTs can build a more inclusive society, driving social and economic progress for all.
When I see the world in general, how many people are not connected to the digital ecosystems. And it is our duty, I think, to bring the opportunities of more people to get engaged.
Giving women and girls access to ICTs has the potential to empower them in all aspects of their lives.
The power of broadband and mobile technology must be harnessed to reach the unreached girls and women with quality learning opportunities.
Technology must be available to female students, entrepreneurs, and policymakers.
New technologies have the power to open up endless opportunities for those living with disability.
My quality of life has changed dramatically since I started using technology. And only the other day, I told my mother that technology is the limb I never had.
ICTs significantly improve quality healthcare for people in poor and remote areas. In Kenya, doctors in rural hospitals use telemedicine technology to get advice from specialists on how best to treat their patients. ICTs are part of the solution in ensuring the sustainable future of our planet. Smart cities will be safer for their citizens and more resilient to a changing climate. As the world faces more extreme weather events, ICTs can save lives.
Mobile systems and technology are the instrument that we have to develop further now to save even more lives. We've got good evidence that it works, but we also have evidence that a lot of the disasters cost more and more in terms of lives lost and economic losses.
Broadband alone is not going to solve those problems, but it can be a really substantial ticket to improving access to the information needed to solve those problems.
I believe the challenge now is for the international community to come together and harness the huge potential that these technologies hold for economic growth and development.
Thank you very much. So to react, first is going to be Your Excellency, the Minister of Japan, Madame Takayuki. Please, the floor is yours.
ざわざわ局長、今日はモデレーターを務めていただき、また最初にご指名をいただき、本当にありがとうございました。すでに開会の、挨拶で私の考え方については述べさせていただきましたので、ここでは、簡潔に IoT 時代のデータの利活用に焦点を絞って私の意見を述べます。情報通信を用いて手続きの電子化やサービスの効率化を進めるという ICT の時代から、あらゆるものがネットワークにつながると、そしてそこで生まれる膨大なデータの利活用によって全く新しい価値やサービスを生み出す IoT の時代への大きな社会変革の中で、多種大量のデータは新たな価値を創造します。そのメリットを最大化するには、 IoT やビッグデータの利活用とそれを支える情報通信インフラを整備することが重要だと考えています。これによって各国の経済発展や社会の利便性向上が図られるということを期待しています。近年、映像配信によりトラフィックは急増しています。IoT やビッグデータの時代にはセンサーなども加わり、データの種類や量が大きくなることから、強靭でしなやかなネットワークが必要となります。日本はこのような未来への投資に貢献する用意がございます。で、特に今後の鍵となるワイヤレス基盤につきましては、携帯電話ネットワークの高度化に加え、それを支える制度の対応が重要です。我が国は M2M 向けの専用番号の創設や、携帯電話における IPv6 の普及といった新たな取り組みを進めています。我が国の経験を各国の皆さんと共有したいと考えています。またデータの利活用により、さまざまなイノベーションやアプリケーションが生まれ、貧困や環境問題の解決、さらには女性を含む新たな雇用機会の創出につながることも期待されます。国際的にデータの利活用を進めていくためには、 IoT やビッグデータが持つ意義を共有し、人材や技術などについて交流を深めていくということが重要です。我が国はIoT 時代のデータ利活用の推進を図っており、今後この動きを世界に広げていきたいと考えています。一方、 IoT というと非常に高度な技術であると考えがちですけれども、必ずそうではありません。従来、人と人中心であったネットワークを、人と物をつなぐネットワークに拡充していくということがエッセンスです。すでに多くの国において携帯電話を活用したさまざまな取り組みがなされています。その取り組みをいかに高度化し、かつ範囲を広げ、社会的課題を解決するかがポイントであると考えています。このような観点から日本の取り組みが参考になれば幸せです。この閣僚ラウンドテーブルの課題は、持続可能な開発目標を達成する上でのICT の役割です。 ICT は持続可能な開発の牽引役としての大きな潜在能力を有していますが、 IoT の時代を迎える中で、そのデータ利活用の在り方も急激に変化をしています。ぜひその利活用の在り方について幅広く閣僚の皆様で活発にご議論をいただけると幸いです。ありがとうございました。
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. I would like to request from the panelists if any one of them intended to intervene quickly. The minister has touched on very interesting topics that include Internet of Things, machine-to-machine communication, and big data. If you could share your perspectives on any of the topics. Let me invite the minister.
Thailand.
Yes, please, from Thailand.
Okay, it's quite impressive to come here. In Thailand, we, in the policy level, we think that the first step, we should make sure that we have a good and enough infrastructure. We mean that digital infrastructure that composed of at least three things. The first one is the broadband connectivity. This is a critical step that everybody in Thailand, on Thai citizen, even the foreigner in Thailand, can access to the broadband anywhere in Thailand, even in the rural area or the remote area. The second critical infrastructure may be the super infrastructure. We call the law regulation that allow everyone who use the internet have a trust and security to use it confidently. In Thailand, we are in the process to upgrade many laws conform to a new standard or even the international standard one. And the third one, when we emphasize on the big data, I think the most important from big data is the result, how to use this kind of data. So in Thailand, we start from how we can use the data from the government sector to convert to a smart service that allow everyone in Thailand benefit from the service from this sector. So we try to transform the government services into a smart service so everyone can use this via many media, just as the mobile phone, tablet, or whatever. And beyond that, we also focus on the economy and society segment that focus on SME and citizen. This is the most important for Thailand and maybe on the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. I think. So, Your Excellency, the Minister of Japan has excused herself, but the Vice Minister is here to contribute to the debate. I would like to open the floor, if there is any indication. Yes, the Minister of Guinea-Bissau, please.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Allow me at the outset to thank the government of Japan for this warm hospitality. For Mr. Chairman, sustainable development goal 9, build resilient infrastructure, promote sustainable industrialization, and foster innovation is the only one that clearly talks about communication infrastructure. And yet, this infrastructure is extremely important on the majority of the goals. For example, if you take goal 9 and poverty, this could be strongly advanced if we could, if the basic financial services could be reached to the extreme poor. Financial services including loans, credits, savings. And yet these profitable models are being used across Africa, and the extreme poor are having access to this type of models without even meeting the banks, the commercial banks. Well, On the same note, we could take, for instance, Sustainable Development Goal 3, good health and well-being. And this could be greatly enhanced as well if by the ability to make it to reach to the poorest of the poor or the least healthy, to have all these kind of information. For instance, Guinea-Bissau, as member of ECOWAS, is part of the West African Health Organization. And part of this process is to design a health information system that take full advantage of a whole data that is generated by is generated over cell phones and SMS applications. So we think that the key issue here is to see how we gonna make sure that ICT could be used till the poorest by lowering the cost of delivery of services. So the same thing could we could have the same analysis with regarding to how ICT can drive innovation and entrepreneurship. And if we look from a government standpoint, we think that there are three things that could be done. First of all, we think that government should not place heavy rules on how innovators should innovate. We think that government should create the spaces and access to technology and that get out of the way. Second thing, we think that the governments should help with mobilization of capital in order to help innovators innovate. And third, it's our understanding that governments should work towards creating incentives for these young innovators. And we have seen a lot of hubs, innovation hubs, and maker spaces around Africa. So to sum up, we think that in order for ICT to play a very important role in achieving sustainable development, we have to work towards reducing the cost of delivery service. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Let me move on to His Excellency, the Deputy Prime Minister of Tonga. His Excellency Sovaleni. He comes from a small island developing state. Last year, there was a huge United Nations conference for the small island developing states in Samoa, and the international community adopted the Samoa pathway. We know small island developing states are unique in many respects. I would like to understand from His Excellency what are his perspectives with regards to measurement, with regards to deployment of ICTs and the use of it to mitigate, for example, the impact of natural disasters or to reduce disasters. Your Excellency, the floor is yours.
Thank you, moderator. This is the first time I'm actually taking the floor. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the government of Japan and ITU for hosting this very important event. As the moderator explained, I'm from a small developing state, Tonga, very close to Samoa. So if you've been to Samoa, it's only 1 hour flight time from Tonga. As discussed in many forums, the challenges that we face in a small island developing states, the fact that we're small, so we don't have economy of scale. And because we are an island, we tend to have a lot of islands. And actually connecting them up or providing the services to all these islands is one of the major challenges that we face. So when we're talking about big data, sometimes the problem in the small island developing state is small data, the lack of data. So that needs to be taken into account, the fact that some of us actually do not have the data. And as policymakers and ministers, what we tend to do is actually provide, through the assistance of ITU and other development agencies, the mechanism to actually collect the data, so to know where we are, so we can actually try and progress to where we want to be. So that's some of the challenges that we face in the Pacific. In talking about some of the key sectors like health and education, as I mentioned earlier on, we tend to have a lot of islands, and actually providing these essential services like education, health, comes with its own problems. And actually pushing an ICT project per se is not that easy, because you actually have to wait up, okay, I have these limited resources, I have this, you know, bilateral assistant with this particular development agencies. So which one is important? Building roads, providing transportation, shipping, or providing ICT? You know, so we need to be very careful on how to articulate the benefits. We need to be very clear on the benefits of ICT, because you actually have to wait up using the limited resources for ICT project or some other development projects, which are, for us, equally important. So integrated is one of those key, I guess, factors that comes into play when considering what we use those limited resources to. And in that same line of thought, it is very important to actually link the indicators that will be, I guess, released tomorrow to the sustainable development goals indicators. Because I'm pretty sure development agencies and other partners have realigned their development assistance in accordance with the SDGs. And actually having the indicators that actually related to the SDGs indicators will help us tap into those resources. And I agree with some of my colleagues when actually, you know, government playing an enabling role. But hopefully some of the points or the issues that I raised can probably generate a few more questions that I'll be happy to answer later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Excellency. Dr. Mlambo, Zimbabwe. Okay. Simultaneous request for the floor. Excuse me. I will move on to the Minister of Zambia. Zambia is a least developed country, and it has got a lot of challenges, but I know that there is quite impressive growth rate in terms of ICTs. Could you, Honorable Minister, share your views?
Yeah, thank you so much. First and foremost, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the government of Japan for hosting this very important symposium. I also want to thank ITU, who have been very candid in regard to the hosting of this symposium. First and foremost, I'm coming from Zambia. I'm the Deputy Minister of Transport and Communication. Coming from Zambia, you know, as an African country in the southern part of the continent, there are a lot of challenges. First, the government must be able to look at what are the areas of priorities. The challenges are so many. You look at poverty, you look at health. In these areas, then the government must be able to sit down and say, where do we go? As the Republic of Zambia, what the government has been able to do is something that is worth noting. The president of the Republic of Zambia has been able to create what I can call a seat at the president's office to deal with excellency. And this excellency office is specifically to address the issues of ICT. Because if the government does not have a deliberate policy to move the ICT development, you find that you always give it a lip service. For example, the government must be able to see to it that in its budget, it must be able to factor a large chunk of resources to go towards the development of ICT. So in the process, the Republic of Zambia has been able to create 204 towers that they've constructed. In addition to the 204 communication towers, they've further increased by 464. And these 464 will be able to cover the unserved and underserved areas in the rural areas. This is how committed the government is as regard to the coverage, which means immediately we are going to finish the 464 towers, the coverage will come to 100%. Furthermore, there is the terrestrial ICT infrastructure that is being laid. And with this, it will mean 108 districts will be covered. And these districts that will be covered in the 108 mostly will be inclined to the rural settings. The other important thing that I think as a government we've been able to do is to ensure that from the positive development that a government is embarking on, the construction of the 409 towers and the coverage of the 100% of the government has also established a terrestrial ICT infrastructure backbone that will connect the districts, with particular emphasis on the connectivity, like I said, on the rural areas. This intervention has resulted into having access to broadband services. For example, the transfer of unbanked money in rural areas. As you know, in most of the rural areas, there are no banks. Most of the commercial banks are not there. Hence, you find that people keep this money in their homes, but they will be able to do that once the connection is done. Then the government also has continuously, go on reviewing the legal and the policy framework. And this is a platform that has resulted into attraction of investment in ICT. Hence, I am here also to try and lobby to you people that those who are well vested in the investment in ICT can come along, because Zambia has been able to liberalize this area and you can be able to come and invest. And this also has also created an enabling environment, like I've said, for the participation of the private sector. So Zambia is a fertile ground for all those that have the knowledge in the investment of the ICT. Then furthermore, the government is looking at the issues of the e-government, which has been introduced. In the e-government, we have what we call the e-visa system. We have also the e-voucher system. This e-voucher system has impacted mostly on agriculture, where the farmers can be able to access inputs using the electronic system. And as a result, this will be able to cover a wider area. We have also looked at the issues of health, because we have come to acknowledge that IC would be able to accelerate the implementation and of the health sector, so that most of our people who are in the rural areas can be able to access health by ensuring that this system goes to those areas, because we are laying the fiber optic, which is cutting across the country, and with the intention to see to it that there is connectivity in the rural settings. Hence, the health areas will be also touched in that regard. I think these are some of the areas that Zambia is doing, and these are the strides that I can see that without the ICT being emphasized, I don't see us as a country surviving, because the only way to go is ICT. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. So I would like to challenge the ministers. It is usually a very rare occasion that we have policymakers with us. We have a lot of technocrats who meet from time to time through online dialogue to develop methodologies for the IDI and to improvise and come up with new innovative ways of data collection. We would like to hear from you, your views pertaining to what you think we could improve or maybe what you think should be done to enhance cooperation between national statistical offices and telecommunications regulatory authorities in order to minimize expenditure in terms and also avoid duplication of effort and resources. So I move on to Thailand. In 2005, the first part, our Secretary General, who was then the director of our Standardization Bureau, was in Thailand in Phuket just after the December 24th tsunami. And the major discussion there was the establishment of a regional tsunami early warning system. And we know Thailand is also one of the vulnerable countries in terms of natural disasters. You are a primary provider for rice. And as climate change impacts are felt across the world, those countries that produce rice like yourselves, you are holding more and more and exporting less. Can you please share with us? And also, if we can concentrate also to some extent, why it is so important to measure and for us to collect the statistics. What is the role of the National Statistical Office in carrying out censuses? And how can we also, during the carrying out of censuses, make sure that those same persons can collect data and information related to information and communication technology, availability and affordability? Please, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much. The first point about a disaster, I think not only in Thailand we have to face and challenge. Every country around this region should work together. Thailand is the one part that we have to handle. In Thailand, we set up the alarming system around the country, alert and try to educate the people in this region how to handle if some things happen. So the technology that we work on is how to send the message, important message to everyone in some certain area. But the most important point is the second question that you mentioned, how we can manage a big data for in the condition of the climate change. In Thailand, we have both the flood season and the drought season in the same year. It's very strange for us, but so we have to make sure that how we can use water and everything in a sufficient way and right way. For the collecting the data in our countries, many organizations working on that, but now we try to use the term the sharing data, open data for the both the government agency and the private sector. The Minister of ICT, the Statistical Bureau, the responsible for the standardization for all the data, metadata, for example, and try to create a method to collect the data more efficiently. I mean, the data is may be real time and correctly. This is a very critical thing. Now we think about how we can use a new method, a new technique to collecting data as the big one, the big data. It is the process that we are focused on. And now I think in Thailand we some kind of showcase for the water management, flood management for both agriculture and the disaster management.
So thank you very much. I would like to ask the Deputy Prime Minister from Ethiopia
to intervene, please.
Thank you.
It's okay. It's okay. So first, I would like to thank Japan government as well as ITU for inviting us for this important platform. And well, I'm not going to introduce about Ethiopia, but I would like to highlight some points for you for how we see ICT in terms of our development. Ethiopia is one of the, of course, poorest country in the world, but at the moment it is one of the fastest growing economy as well. We have a vision to be a middle-income country in 2025. So the last decade we are growing double digits. And in view of this, we see ICT is one of the critical intervention that we need to accelerate our development. We are working on agriculture, that's our priority. Our priority is to eradicate poverty. So we have to highly invest on agriculture, education, health, but we fully believe that without ICT, we cannot move fast. So we feel ICT is a necessity. And this is a very great instrument and intervention to speed up and to catch up for the other countries. So we have a policy that has that addresses, you know, ICT as a two-prong intervention. When we say it's an enabler for all the, of all of the development interventions we have, as I said, on education, agriculture, we use to have ICT to speed up. The other prong is to take ICT as a sector, as an industry. But the main thrust in our case is to use ICT as enabler. And just to mention one, to have a quality of education, we need quality instructors. But for countries like us, who is very big, we cannot have a quality teachers in all areas, in urban and rural. So we use digital content to broadcast to all the remote areas using satellite. So all our high schools are connected by satellite. So we say this is helping us to deliver quality education in all the remote areas by using ICT. So we are addressing the shortage of skilled manpower in education, and also we are addressing the distance gap by using ICT. We have also used ICT in health, in like telemedicine and many others. So it's incorporated in our development strategy, and we feel that government has a big role to play. For countries like us who are, as I said, left behind, we have to move fast in a great gear. To do so, government has to have a very clear policy, but not only policy, but it has to be an interventionist government. That's what we feel. And being in Japan and learning also from the history of Japan, the government has had a big role to change and to bring the latest developments in the country. And we are learning from Japan as well as from Korea. At the early stage, you have to intervene. Every intervention should not be left for the market or for the private sector. In fact, for countries like us, where we have a weak private sector, even to develop the private sector, the government has to have instruments to encourage the private sector to get the business, to get into the development. So government has a lot to play in poor countries like us. So this is just an introductory remark, but I will come back later on other issues, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. So I think my understanding, we got from the Deputy Prime Minister two key points that relate to the need to mainstream ICTs and also to convert whatever we have in terms of communications to an instrument that we can use to facilitate socio-economic development. Let me go to the Philippines. Sorry, Minister, I came back to you a little bit late. But I know that in 2013, you suffered a major disaster, which was one of the most powerful. Supercyclone Haiyan brought a lot of challenges. Infrastructure was wrecked and destroyed, and many people lost their lives. But we also know that you are on a fast track in terms of development. If you could share with us what it is that you are doing and doing right, which is making you speeding up development, and also what are you doing, because we know your statistical office is doing a great work, and they work with us in the expert group on telecommunications indicators and group on households indicators. So we would like to hear your perspective from a policy level. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. First of all, I'd like to thank the country of Japan for the kind hospitality, and also for ITU for co-sponsoring or organizing this event. I'd like to share with you the Philippine experience on how the use of ICT as a driver for sustainable development. Sustainable development is getting growth, economic growth, that is environmentally sound, that focuses on poverty alleviation and sharing of prosperity across the society. In the Philippines, we use the best science and technology to come up with initiatives that supports our development programs to be able to achieve sustainable development. And always, in all our initiative, ICT is embedded directly or indirectly. It cut across all different initiatives for sustainable development. Now, sustainable development touches many areas. That includes agriculture, energy, water resources, among others. And also disaster preparedness, as mentioned earlier by our moderator. I'd just like to share with you two examples regarding smart agriculture and how ICT has enabled us to improve our disaster preparedness. We call it smart agriculture. Through ICT, we're able to come up or be able to process, our scientists were able to process, come up with information that benefits the farmers using weather information and coming up with, again, as I mentioned earlier, information that enables the farmers to guide the farmers when to plant, what to plant, when to apply fertilizer, when to harvest, based on site-specific weather information. And this results to lesser fertilizer needed, maybe we're looking at 25% lesser fertilizer inputs, lesser water needed than the normal practice that our farmers is doing. But it is through ICT that will make this available to all the farmers in the Philippines. And parallel to this program is building up of our connectivity infrastructure, again, to enable our farmers to get this information and improve their efficiency, their productivity. Again, going back to inclusive growth, directly benefiting the people in the countryside. Now let's go to how ICT has really dramatically improved our disaster preparedness. We do it two ways. One is improving our weather forecasting, improving our modeling, improving the way we using data from more than 1,500 to 2,000 weather sensors to come up with modeling, to come up with early warning for flood, landslide, and others. We have been hit by, as mentioned by the Mr. Moderator, by Typhoon Yolanda, which resulted to thousands of lives lost. And this is not only one, this is only one of the extreme weather events that has affected the Philippines. But because of ICT, because of our improvement in providing early warning, we have been hit by many other extreme weather events, and yet we suffered zero casualties in most of them. Only last month, we were hit by Typhoon Lando, which caused massive landslide and buried thousands of homes, and yet there was no casualty, all because of using ICT to be able to deliver early warning to the public and to our disaster manager and come up with a proper response. This just shows how powerful and how beneficial ICT, especially in the Philippines and countries like the Philippines and maybe to all to all countries. And that is, we're touching only in two areas, and there are several areas wherein ICT is really a great enabler. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you very much, Minister. Dr. Mlambo, Deputy Minister from Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe is a landlocked country, and in 2014, there was a conference in Vienna, and that conference was on the ALMAT agreement, which seeks to assist landlocked countries. What do you think in terms of having access to the sea? Dependence on coastal countries for you to have access for purposes of cutting costs, increasing speed and bandwidth, and also we have noted that we have got a delegation which is composed of both the statistical office and the regulatory agency, and both of them seem to work together to collect data. What are your perspectives, and what are you doing in Zimbabwe to improve connectivity, usage, and skill sets in terms of ICTs?
Thank you very much, Rapporteur. I think being a landlocked country is very, very bad, because it has costs that have to be driven down to the consumer, and they don't like it. But let me first add chorus to many of us who have thanked the host for the hospitality and everything which we are enjoying. I want to make two broad statements before I go into specifics, as requested by the rapporteur. Firstly, being an MP, just like many of us here, you'll be transiting during the week between policymakers, that will be your audience, and come the weekend, you'll be seated under a log, under a tree, on a log, and addressing the proletariat and the most uneducated audience. Now, what is common between the two distinct audiences is their need for solutions, ICT solutions, to address their different types of problems. Now, I also then realize that many solution providers make a mistake of thinking on behalf of the rural folk, for example. They come up with solutions which are a complete misfit to the rural audience, to the challenges that they have. I'll come to that a bit later on. Now, when you are a consumer of bandwidth and you are a landlocked country, it means that you have to pay costs. You are charged by countries through which your bandwidth transits. And those costs have got to be, if you're a businessman, transmitted down, as I say, to the consumer. And that means the rates have got to remain high. So these are issues that the common consumer does not understand, or they don't understand why the rates are so high. And those who have the ability to read around and also compare the rates, perhaps in the surrounding countries, some of them have access to the undersea cables, do not understand why you yourself, your rates are high. And when you explain that you are paying rates, you continue confusing them. I wanted to debunk the mythos around these ICT issues when it comes to provision of solutions. You know, they talk about big data, Internet of Things, which keep on frightening people and make them fail to implement solutions on time because they are not very, very confident. And they keep on hoping that perhaps the next symposium or conference will give them enough information to then start implementing. Now, these comments are more appropriate to developing countries like Zimbabwe. instead of, in my view, yes, we must think big, but we must then start small and start immediately to implement. Then the next symposium or conference will then give you information which you are going to use to panel beat the works in progress, to panel beat what you are already implementing, and you move forward. I can talk specifically then about some of the solutions that are in the rural areas, which I think needed to be adopted or implemented almost now. In a very small, very simple way. We can talk about the unavailability of cell phones in the rural areas. And yet, those people require, again, solution providers make an assumption that everybody in the rural areas can afford a cell phone, which is not true. And for that matter, smart cell phones, which are expensive, which is also not true. And yet, as I said earlier on, they require solutions. Now, by creating what, in my mind, can call a virtual cell phone, then you will be targeting those many people who don't have a platform like this one here to discuss or to tell the solution providers about their plight, that we want also to receive money through a cell phone, but we don't have the cell phone. So what do? You can provide a virtual cell phone. You can create an agent at a central place. Then you create virtual numbers, specific numbers and unique numbers associated with each household or a member of each household. So the agent, once received money, that agent has received the money, tied to that number, which in turn is tied to a certain member of a household, can deliver the money to that person. We can talk about clinics. In Zimbabwe, we have a problem that many patients do not have doctors. In other words, the doctor-to-patient ratio is disappointingly low, and that is going to remain with us for quite some time. And yet, people need solutions. So what do? It's up to us now to think about how to include those marginalized communities quickly and now, and by being very simple. This is my point. You then can start with a very simple phone, not these multicolored smartphones that are multicolored with apps and so forth, loaded with apps which people don't really need and will never use. By just coming up with one app with a very simple cell phone, and you load it with the medical information there, which can be used by nurses, which also are too busy to scan through a lot of apps to identify the app which they want to access medical data and to consult a virtual doctor on a cell phone. I'm talking about simple things that can provide immediate solution and reprieve in the rural areas. What do we then use to measure that simple thing? If I'm given the opportunity later on, I'll give more examples, which again for African countries can become beneficial. You use simple things. Again, let us not become complicated. If we provide medical information to the rural folk, what then do you look for to assess whether it's making an impact? You look whether they are dying or not. That's very simple. You look whether there's an increase or not in the usage of these mobile phones. You look at increased infrastructure, because when all these fundamentals are taken care of, you find the economy starting to react to that basic solution which you have given them. Increase in businesses and so forth. These, in my view, are simple indicators that can tell you that your solution is becoming useful or it's not. If it is not, then you adjust through the information gleaned from symposia like these ones. Let me stop there, Mr. Rapporteur, for now.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so one point which I liked was the fact that he says we are going to raise issues and come back to see whether these were taken into account. So you are most welcome. I will come back to you, Honorable Minister. Allow me, please, to move to Malaysia. If you could make your intervention, please.
Thank you, Excellency Moderator. Very good morning. And thank you to Japan. Thank you to ITU. You make it happen that I'm here today, and I feel so honored and privileged to be here because I thought that I'm going to be the last speaker, Mr. Moderator. But it's okay. I'm trying to set a little bit of a new approach when we talk about data collection, statistics, and indicators. What I want to introduce here, Mr. Moderator, and ladies and gentlemen, is about the citizen-centric data collection, which I think have been discussed many times, but have not been successfully implemented. What I'm trying to say here is that I think Excellency Brahima said that ICT is about people. So I just would like to pose a question. To what extent, actually, we use people, we communicate with people, we consult people on the ground, we engage them, we co-create with them, and we co-produce the data that all statisticians, regulators, we, the planners, and also decision makers. What is it that we have done so far that actually make people on the ground feel that their inputs are recognized and that their feedbacks are taken into consideration for data and for the for statistics to be used? We all know that ICT is an enabler. It is a driving force to generating knowledge, to creating wealth, and to uplift the well-being of the people. But still, the question is, to what extent do we engage those people who are actually the users of ICT? In Malaysia, we call it the Blue Ocean Strategy, or we call it citizen-centric service delivery. And we have implemented a lot and a lot of programs that actually based on that, where we use people, we use their inputs, because we believe in social inclusion. We believe in inclusive innovation. Inclusive innovation is to tap the mind of the people, the innovation and the creativity of the people on the ground, of the B40, if you wish, we call them now. And to Malaysia, we feel that we have been quite successful when we do this, because actually we take care of their interests, of their concern, and what exactly do they need for their own specific problems that we come up with the solution that just now we are talking about. So, for example, we introduce Connecting the Unconnected. That is one of our programs now, where we reach out to the people on the ground. We go to them, we went to the remote area, we ask them, what is exactly your problem? Do you have a penetration? Do you have access to broadband? What is happening actually to you here? Do you have a clear television? Do you have a radio station? What is it that you have? I'm not talking about urban or suburb. It is about a very, very remote area that I myself will go down. We will go down. It took us nearly the whole day. You climb up the hill, you go down, you go by boat, and at the end of the day, you meet them. This is what citizen-centric administration is all about. So this is what we have been doing. We use crowdsourcing for e-Rezeki. That is one of our program. E-Rezeki is the entrepreneurship where we put them online, we teach them, we coach them, we mentor them, and at the end of the day, they earn more than what they are supposed to earn. Okay? And we also have our e-Usahawan, or we call it more into entrepreneurship as well, where we get into them, we talk to them, and most of them are actually from the TVET. They are there, they are just like very young people, and one of them at the age of 18 years old, the result is awesome, the result is amazing, where you can see this 18-year-old now is no more a mediocre. He is now a leader, an entrepreneur who earned like 95,000 a month. That is great, and all is because of ICT. And all is because we reach out to the people on the ground. This is what actually I would want to to inform the statisticians, the regulators, planners, and decision makers that if we say the mind of the people, the mind at the margin, should not be marginalized because they know exactly what they want. We cannot make decision for them. And when we are with them, we can indeed create what we call an informed decision, a sense of belonging, a sense of ownership, which finally will help us in the implementation of our work, which is not easy. It is always very, very difficult to deal with the people who are actually the users and to take care of their concern and their interest. So that is for a moment, Mr. Moderator. Maybe we would want to come back later to talk about citizen-centric blue ocean strategy and things that we have implemented in Malaysia. Thank you.
I think you are cordially invited to the Cyberjaya in Malaysia as well. So thank you very much for that. Let me move on to the Minister of Namibia, who made every effort to be with us. I know that you wanted to be with us from the beginning. May you please take the floor?
Well, is it already on? Thank you. Technological challenge. Well, when my colleague from Tonga was talking, it reminded me of our game of World Rugby at Exeter in the UK. But this is now ICT platform. There's no more rugby where you hammered us. Thank you for being here. On behalf of my delegation, they had a warm reception. I cannot say the same. We leave it there. In Namibia, we have this component under one roof called ICT, Information, Communication, and Technology. Friday, the 27th, we had our regional and local authority elections. We used technology, electronic voting machines for the second time. And as I was traveling, and today, merely after 48 hours, from all 14 regions, 121 districts, we have all results known. From a landscape of over 824,000 square kilometer, simply by the use of technology, we have a taste of that. In Namibia, we use technology in government, e-government, hosted by the Office of the Prime Minister, but when it comes to the systems, they resort under the Ministry of ICT. The police are using e-policing. Criminals that run from Namibia across border through Interpol, we use technology. In the Ministry of Home Affairs, the processing of documents such as passports or visas, previously it used to give us nightmares, and nowadays the many months has become to mere 3 days by using technology. As far as the democracy is concerned, of which most of us are concerned, we use technology to reach out to the rural community, to involve them, to participate through radios, television. My colleague from Zambia spoke of the digital terrestrial television, DTT. In SADC, we have given ourselves a D-Day of June this year, for which Namibia has also met her expectations to meet that D-Day, to reach out to the then deadline, but we actually reached up to 70% of the entire country to cover, including those in the remote areas where they can have the necessary information about the government programs and how they can participate in terms of democratic governance. In as far as the private sector is concerned, we have got online banking, e-banks. It helps the rural communities who do not need to have a bank account simply to have a friend or a neighbor cell phone through what we call e-wallet. They can send through e-wallet and they will receive their money simply by a touch of a button. ICT in Namibia is taking its rightful place, and because of its importance to fight poverty in Namibia, we do not believe in poverty reduction. We talk of poverty eradication. Half poverty is not good enough. We don't want poverty at all. We talk of poverty eradication. What is then the contribution of ICT towards this poverty eradication? We believe ignorant, through lack of information, whether to participate democratically or in schools or having any information about any services, is by empowering them through mind, and that is through ICT. We therefore aim for 100% coverage in the whole country so that all Namibians have got the rightful constitutional obligation, right to information. And through that, we will be able to communicate by using technology to the best. We can engage some more, but as an introductory, allow me to stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. So it's no disaster mitigation, it's no disaster at all, it's no poverty mitigation, but there is zero tolerance on poverty. So we understand, and congratulations for the massive deployment of ICTs in Namibia. I've got three remaining ministers to speak. You get ready with your questions or comments. I will be opening the floor, but I will revisit some of the ministers who have indicated that they have an interest in taking the floor. I will, once I open the floor, ask the director of the BDT, Ms. Ibrahima Sanu, to share with you. He launched a very innovative initiative which is called the Smart Sustainable Development Model, what it is and how it will contribute to the post-2015 development agenda. With these words, I would like to invite His Excellency, the Minister of Gabon, Nguaneme. The floor is yours, please.
Merci, Monsieur le Modérateur. Tout d'abord, comme les autres, je voudrais dire merci au Japon et merci à l'UIT pour avoir organisé cette réunion. Je voudrais dire aussi que le Gabon, comme les autres pays, partage la conviction que les technologies de l'information et de la communication peuvent transformer la vie. Et au Gabon, ces dernières années, fort de cette conviction, nous pensons que la première chose à faire, c'est multiplier la connectivité. Nous avons multiplié considérablement la connectivité internationale. Ce qui reste à faire, c'est la connectivité à l'intérieur du pays. Et donc, nous nous sommes engagés dans un vaste programme pour construire un réseau national en fibre optique. Et c'est ce qui garantit que, par la suite, nous pouvons développer au bénéfice des populations et mettre les TIC au service de l'ensemble des populations. Mais d'ores et déjà, nous n'avons pas attendu, nous n'attendons pas que le réseau en fibre optique soit totalement en place. Avec ce qui a été fait et grâce à l'appui du secteur privé, nous développons déjà un certain nombre de programmes. Comme les collègues l'ont mentionné tout à l'heure, il n'est pas possible d'installer des écoles partout, ni des dispensaires, souvent dans des pays qui sont très élevés, grâce au TIC, des projets expérimentaux en matière d'éducation et de santé sont mis en place actuellement au Gabon. Il faut savoir que le secteur des TIC au Gabon est parmi les plus dynamiques, où les petites entreprises se créent. Et actuellement, le secteur des TIC pèse à peu près 5% de la richesse nationale. Mais ce chiffre est appelé à progresser. Grâce aux technologies 3G, 4G, nous améliorons l'inclusion numérique et financière des populations. Comme on l'a mentionné tout à l'heure, grâce simplement au téléphone portable qui devient un portefeuille électronique, on peut transférer de l'argent. On peut également gérer son compte à la poste grâce au TIC, ce qui constitue des améliorations significatives pour la vie des gens. Mais je voudrais mentionner également une expérience très intéressante en matière de lutte contre le changement climatique. Le Gabon a réceptionné récemment une station d'observation spatiale. Et cette station d'observation spatiale vise à surveiller les conséquences du changement climatique sur le couvert forestier du Gabon, sa biodiversité et sur la répartition des terres. Cette station, par ses observations, aide également les agriculteurs, notamment sur le plan météorologique. Mais cette station qui couvre 21 pays d'Afrique de l'Ouest et du Centre, le Gabon est prêt à partager les résultats des observations spatiales à tous les pays qui le souhaitent pour pouvoir bénéficier et engager des programmes de recherche scientifique en matière de changement climatique. Donc nous avons, voilà, au Gabon, ce que les TIC ont commencé à faire. Et probablement à l'avenir, l'ensemble de ces programmes sera systématisé.
Merci beaucoup pour votre contribution. Let me move on to Guinea-Bissau. Your Excellency, if you could make your intervention. Equatorial Guinea-Bissau.
Bueno. Es verdad que soy al lado de mi colega de Guinea-Bissau, pero soy de Guinea Ecuatorial. Gracias, señor moderador. Y también me voy a sumar al agradecimiento al país anfitrión, que es Japón, también a la Organización Internacional de Telecomunicaciones. Estamos hablando de las TIC, de las tecnologías de la información y la comunicación. Voy a hacer una breve reseña sobre mi país, lo que estamos haciendo, lo que hemos hecho y lo que esperamos conseguir. Guinea Ecuatorial es un pequeño país de apenas 28.000 kilómetros cuadrados, menos de 1,5 millones de habitantes. Guinea Ecuatorial, desde el año 2000, estamos sumidos en un vasto programa de desarrollo que hemos llamado Guinea Ecuatorial Horizonte 2020. Esto significa que para el año 2020 queremos llegar a convertirnos en un país emergente. Pero somos conscientes que la emergencia económica, no podemos llegar a la emergencia económica sin el pleno desarrollo de la tecnología, la información y la comunicación. Teniendo en cuenta esto, nuestro gobierno en los últimos 5 años ha hecho un esfuerzo enorme, una inversión importante en estas tecnologías. Hoy en Guinea Ecuatorial tenemos cerca de 2.000 kilómetros de fibra óptica que conectan a todo el país. Tenemos el país unido, el país consta de dos regiones, una insular y una continental, y tenemos la isla y el continente unidos con dos cables de cable submarino. Y estamos también uniéndonos en los últimos meses con Camerún con un tercer cable. Eso significa que nuestro país cree que las nuevas tecnologías de la información y comunicación van a ser un acelerante del desarrollo del país, que sin ellas va a ser imposible conseguir los objetivos. Si bien ahora las estadísticas de nuestro país son bajas en la utilización de Internet, porque de verdad que todo esto no se habría podido hacer sin inversión, sin medios. Nuestro país últimamente ha crecido mucho económicamente gracias al descubrimiento del petróleo. Creo que muchos países africanos tienen este problema. La poca utilización de las tecnologías de la información y la comunicación también dependen del nivel de la capacidad económica de los países. Hemos tenido la suerte que en los últimos años el país ha crecido enormemente, económicamente, y hemos podido hacer estas inversiones. Pero nuestras estadísticas, debo reconocerlo, siguen siendo muy bajas. Por ejemplo, el uso de Internet, a pesar de tener el país casi un 97% conectado, el uso de Internet apenas supera el 10%. Eso también depende de la formación de la población, porque bueno, el gobierno está haciendo grandes inversiones, pero esas inversiones es para que las use la gente, no solo el gobierno. El gobierno está informatizando la administración y creemos que en los próximos años nuestras estadísticas van a mejorar y el uso de las tecnologías de información y la comunicación va a ser una realidad en Guinea. Yo esta mañana he mirado un poco las estadísticas que publica la Organización Internacional de Telecomunicaciones y debo reconocer que son muy bajas por falta de datos actualizados de nuestro país y creemos que el gobierno es consciente de esto y en los próximos años vamos a mejorar las estadísticas porque creemos que no podremos progresar sin el uso de estas tecnologías.
Thank you very much, Excellency. We have taken note of that, and we appreciate your comments. Allow me to give the floor back to His Excellency, the Minister of Zambia, who wants to make an intervention. Sorry for getting back to you a little bit late. Thank you.
Please. Thank you. First, I'd like to just tie my talk to Zambia and Zimbabwe. Zambia and Zimbabwe, these are no separate countries. I think most of the challenges we face are very common. On the use of statistical data, as Zambia, we have realized that it is very important in the sense that it will be able to give us the near to measure of assistance required in terms of quantity in the provisions of goods and services. What type of assistance, in what quantities, and what should be done, and how it should be done. Zambia is further, being a landlocked country, constructing several rail lines to open the country. We are constructing one line which is going to Mozambique. We are also constructing a line which is through Malawi, which we are calling Chipata Mchinji. We have also a Benguela rail line going into Angola. We have another line which is going into Zimbabwe. We are trying to open up because we have appreciated that ICT plays a very important role. Then the other important thing that Zambia has been able to realize is the development of alternative energy, because for ICT to be continuously there is need for energy also to be provided for. Because what has been happening is that we have been dependent mostly on hydroelectricity. Now we've gone further to try and open up in seeing that we go into alternative energy like solar. So And the other thing that we have been able to look at is the level of literacy. You would find that if you are talking about ICT, you must be able to create a base from primary school. So Zambia further has factored an educational curriculum where there is ICT programs starting at the primary school. Mr. Moderator, I thought those are some of the issues that I would be able to contribute. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Before I open the floor, I see there is a request for the floor from Dr. Mlambo from Zimbabwe. Is there another minister who wants to take the floor before I open the floor? Yes, and the Deputy Prime Minister after that. Then I will open the floor. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for allowing me to come back. I am, again, in an attempt to encourage African countries who are here and other developing countries. But for the developed countries, these are opportunities for you to make money. I wanted to say to you, perhaps we can draw lessons from Peter Drucker, who said, big thoughts are fun to romanticize, but it's many small insights coming together that bring ideas into the world. I thought this becomes very relevant to what we are doing here, to say, let us implement now the ideas which we have. And as I said earlier on, we panel beat them as we get more information from conferences like these ones here. We shouldn't delay. That is the import of that quotation from Peter Drucker. In the examples I gave, where we address our people, giving them a solution. Before I came here, on the eve of coming here, I received a message that a certain blind person wanted to see me. Then I couldn't because I was already preparing. But I said, can you try to get the message to me by internet, which he did. I received the message yesterday. It's a moving one. In there, the blind person cited why a Nokia removed the E5s and the E75s from the market, which they were using as blind people. And they introduced smartphones, which are very complicated and out of reach. That's a blind person. Coming back to the question that the developed world are leaders in technology, developing world are consumers of technology, but unfortunately, the people who earn money who are the developed world craft inappropriate solutions for those people who need the solutions. And in the end, you lose money. And those who are supposed to get solutions don't get the solutions. Quite a misfit. I liked what my colleague here said. It's very, very appropriate. Let us take solutions to people rather than people moving to solution centers or service centers. No. Otherwise, ICTs are meaningless. They are supposed to make humanity better, civilizations better. In Zimbabwe, again, coming back to my colleague from Zambia, where we think that, let's start simple. You find that the pensioners, those people who retired from their jobs and are waiting to get a little money every month, some of them travel long distances to payment centers. They use more money to travel than the money they want to get. When they get there, they are given that they are forced to sleep overnight because there will be long queues. Now, when they do that, they are forced again to borrow some money for food. The following day, they get the little money. Then when they pay back the money for food, they remain with nothing. They don't quite understand. They get back poorer. They don't understand what has gone wrong with them. And yet now, by providing ICT solutions and taking payment centers to them,
where they come from would have resolved a problem under the import or context of including those marginalized communities using ICTs. I said we tend to be very complicated in thinking about simple solutions. We shouldn't do that. Let's start simple. The same with the GAB, grain marketing boards, as we call them in Zimbabwe. Because the greatest contributor of the staple food in Zimbabwe are the communal farmers. They contribute more than commercial farmers. They are spread around the countries. But when it comes to payments for their contribution to the grain centers, we expect them to move, to travel to grain centers to get their payments. But again, by thinking about appropriate solutions, ICT solutions, we then make them receive their payments where they are so that they concentrate on farming rather than them getting them inconvenienced and narrowing their profit margins by getting them to profit centers. Allow me, I know I'm running out of time, Mr. Rapporteur. Why is it that people might have GPS gadgets in disaster areas, but they still die? Why is it that we attend so many conferences, but we don't implement solutions? People remain poor. Why is it like that? I've identified lack of clarity of awareness at police level and at political high level of the issues which we are discussing. I've also identified lack of follow-through and follow-up of things which we do, starting from these workshops. When we get home, another bag is already packed to get to the next workshop. And there's no time to analyze what we have gleaned from such a workshop and its importance, and to make an effort to implement what we have done. So the cycle repeats and people become poorer. So we are meetings of people who discuss contradictory issues when it comes to implementations. What we discuss and what we implement are two different things. Otherwise, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your contribution. Thank you. So thank you very much. I recognize the Deputy Prime Minister and then the Vice Minister of Japan. Deputy Prime Minister of Tonga, please.
Thank you, moderator. I just want to have a quick intervention because I have to leave the room pretty soon. You can catch me on the tea break or lunch. In the latest World Risk Register, listing all the vulnerable countries in the world, number one is Vanuatu. Number two is Philippines. Number three is Tonga. So a lot of the top 10 vulnerable countries in the world are actually, from the Pacific or around here in the panel here. Basically what I want to say is that disaster is something that we live with day in, day out, and it's something that we take seriously. One of our direction that we're taking right now is actually investing more in the resilience of our countries with the hope that that will reduce the aftermath or the losses after cyclones or volcanoes or what have you. Take, for example, some of the projects right now are more inclined focusing on building our resilience. We're currently implementing a project to actually strengthening our institutional arrangement, our key agencies. And one of those components there is actually providing a more robust communication system to ensure that even in a cyclone, or a Category 5 cyclones, these key stakeholders can still communicate, because we believe that's how we can mitigate, how we can reduce potential problems from natural hazards or natural disasters. So, we have that component, and it's disaster related. But at the same time, thinking outside the box, we actually run e-government services on top of that disaster infrastructure. Donors or development partners are very hesitant to actually provide funding on a purely ICT project. But we have this particular component on reducing the risk associated with disaster by providing more robust communications. And therefore, we can actually run e-government services on top of that disaster network. So in a small country such as Tonga, we have to be innovative in how we actually try and make the most of the resources that we have. I'd like to acknowledge the assistance from ITU in providing communication services to some of our unconnected islands in Tonga, because that also serve as a backup to the telecos that are actually in those islands. If those telecos goes down, we still have the communication system provided by ITU as a backup, making it more resilient, to, in our case, to disasters. Similarly, I appreciate the government of Japan's assistance. They provided some sirens, because Tonga, as in most Pacific countries, are very they have a lot of low-lying islands that are more susceptible for storm surge, tsunami, and so forth. So we learned from Japan's experience and actually trying to put a few sirens in place so that hopefully we can actually warn our people and give them enough time to actually evacuate. And just to add into it, we recognize the need to actually bring data together. And so what we're trying to do, because right now we have different agencies that actually collect different information about weathers and what have you. So what we're trying to do is actually bring them together into a Mayhews, what they call multi-hazard early warning systems. Because basically having all those information in one place can actually make you, well, give you the opportunity to make informed decision about warning, about raising awareness, about training, and actually about telling people about disasters and warning them about it. So those are some, I guess, possible way forward in actually dealing with disaster. And that's why, I mean, a lot of Pacific Islands in Paris right now for the COP21, because disaster related to climate change is a serious business for us in the Pacific. Thank you, moderator.
Thank you very much, Deputy Prime Minister. This is very important. And because the Deputy Prime Minister might leave before I draw my conclusions, he's referring, of course, to the ITU connectivity project that was signed by ITU and the heads of state, 11 of them, in Samoa when the World Conference for the Small Island Developing States was taking place. So there was a side event to connect communities in those countries and make sure that there would be a relationship between socioeconomic development, disaster risk reduction, and also disaster response. So thank you for making those remarks. Let me take...
Just one second.
Okay, sure, yeah, please.
I cannot leave this hall without informing you that we need the gender disaggregated data. And I really would like statisticians and all of us here, please pursue again the gender disaggregated, gender budgeting, whatever we have, for the women. Because in Malaysia, just a second, I would like to inform you that the flood management system, for example, we simulate, and there's a lot of women and children that actually helping us in the flood management system. So we need to get them the gender disaggregated data to be again on the agenda of ITU. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for those remarks. Thank you. I would like to invite the Vice Minister of Japan, who has been quite instrumental. The government of Japan was the first government to come on board when the ITU Plan Potential Conference in Busan, Korea last year adopted Resolution 202, which introduces for the first time the use of information and communication technologies, particularly big data, for epidemics. And we launched a project which is co-financed by ITU and Japan, and we launched it on the 28th of August in Sierra Leone, Freetown, and the President Koroma, and 434 participants were there, including ambassadors and 15 ministers divided between ICTs and health. So with that, I would like to give him the floor, and also, of course, in response to Super Cyclone Haiyan, which hit Philippines. They contributed a mobile unit, which is very good for disaster response efforts, and I think they are exhibiting it here, so you are invited to go there. So the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much, moderator. And moderator already pointed out that in the big data era, and the first challenge is how to collect a lot of data automatically. And I propose from the viewpoint of government role. And government has a lot of data or statistics, but they are not led by computer. Yeah, and usually they are based paper based, not machine readable. And we have to promote open data policy and open government. It's not only central government, but also local government. And we set a common standard regarding machine readable. And in Japan case, and each ministry has own format. We cannot cooperate such kind of data by computer. And now we already set a common standard. And when we combined government data and private data, we create new value and find solution by using such kind of data. And this is only Japan trial, and I want to make a common standard for worldwide. This is my proposal. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. I would like to thank all the ministers. We will come to the closing. We haven't reached there yet because we would like the audience to share with you their perspectives and also ask questions. In inviting interventions and questions, I would like to urge you to be even shorter than the ministers, so 1 minute would be good. And we have a prize for the shortest intervention, so. having said that, let me invite the director of the BDT to share with you a very innovative solution, which is called SSDM for Sustainable Development Model. Please.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Modérateur. J'ai lancé cette initiative en partant d'un constat très simple. Lorsque un pays est frappé par un désastre naturel, les premières 48 heures à 72 heures sont les plus importantes pour sauver les vies. Généralement, ce qui arrive, c'est que nous sommes tous émotionnels. Chacun veut faire quelque chose. Mais malheureusement, il arrive quelquefois que l'aéroport est fermé pendant les premiers jours, des fois parce que la piste elle-même est endommagée quand il s'agit d'un tremblement de terre, des fois parce que ceux qui y travaillent eux-mêmes sont victimes du désastre. Donc, nous trouvons dans une situation où nous arrivons toujours un peu tard. Et comme vous le savez, ces dernières années, nous avons beaucoup plus de désastres naturels que nous avions avant. Il y a un rythme accéléré de désastres naturels liés au changement climatique. Alors, cette initiative que j'ai lancée a pour objectif, en fait, de s'arranger à ce qu'on puisse avoir sur le terrain des équipements pour aider à organiser la réponse aux désastres naturels. Et bien sûr, on a eu des cas où on avait des équipements comme ça, mais à force de les laisser dans un coin, lorsque le désastre arrive, on va regarder les équipements. Des fois, les piles ne marchent plus parce que ça fait longtemps que c'est posé dans un coin. Alors, l'idée ici, oui, c'est faire en sorte que cela puisse servir. Et l'idée est basée sur le fait qu'on utilise ces équipements. Lorsqu'il n'y a pas de désastre, ces équipements sont utilisés pour faire pour les petits business au niveau des zones rurales qui sont souvent les plus en fait vulnérables. Et lorsqu'il y a un désastre, ces équipements deviennent systématiquement des équipements pour aider à faire face aux désastres naturels, aux besoins de communication. Donc c'est ça. En ça, nous lions en fait la gestion des désastres naturels avec le développement durable. S'il n'y a pas de désastre, c'est bon. Ils utilisent les mêmes équipements pour faire du business, généralement dans les villages. Mais dès qu'il y a un désastre, le business est arrêté, ils deviennent les premiers. Donc, dès les premières heures, on peut avoir sur place des équipements qui peuvent servir. Et j'ai mis en place un groupe consultatif qui m'aide à mettre cette initiative en place. Je suis content de savoir que Sakamoto-san est un des membres de ce groupe consultatif. Une quinzaine de personnes dans le monde qui m'aident à avancer cela. Et nous sommes allés à une phase seconde maintenant où nous voulons travailler sur l'ensemble de l'écosystème du désastre naturel. Avant le désastre, tout ce qui est sensors à mettre en place, l'organisation à mettre en place, parce que aussi ce qui arrive, c'est que des fois, en cas de désastre, c'est l'organisation nationale même qui n'est pas là. Vous ne savez pas qui prend le pouvoir, chacun veut faire. Alors, il faut qu'on arrive à trouver un écosystème, trouver, mettre en place un plan national en fait, de gestion des catastrophes qui permette de mettre tout cela ensemble pendant le désastre dont je parlais et aussi après le désastre. Parce que notre sensibilité s'arrête quand le désastre est fini, mais nous laissons derrière nous des gens qui sont impliqués et qui ont impacté pour toute leur vie. Comment nous faisons après le désastre pour faire en sorte qu'ils reviennent à la vie normale et mettre en place les équipements? Voilà un peu cette initiative, je pense, qui ne répond pas à toutes les questions, mais c'est déjà ça de gagner. Et je pense que si on travaille autour de ça, on doit pouvoir, en fait, maîtriser totalement, mais en fait, jouer notre rôle lorsque, dans le cas des désastres naturels. Voilà un peu ce qui est en place. Ça ne répond pas à toutes les questions qui ont été posées, mais c'est déjà une partie de la réponse si nous travaillons ensemble. Merci, Monsieur le modérateur.
Thank you very much. This is an initiative, as the director said, which is people-oriented and people-centered, as the representative of Malaysia said. I recognize the representative of the government of Sierra Leone, who would like to make an intervention, please. The floor is yours. Sierra Leone, do you still want to?
Yes.
Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for recognizing me. And I want to apologize profusely for the absence of my minister. I am a member of parliament. I'm the leader of the House of Parliament of Sierra Leone. I've listened to contributions of ministers. I want to zero my intervention here by quoting the director when he said, giving ICT a human face. That touches me, and I want to relate it to what we have gone through. We have just been declared as a country, Sierra Leone, Ebola-free about a month ago. And giving ICT a human face, why it touches me, my old grandmother, the first time I gave her a cell phone, to speak, she told me she cannot speak because she don't understand English. I said, no, you can communicate in any language. He said, no, the usual courtesy in the telephone is normally, hello, and she cannot say that. So today, if the director is encouraging us to give ICT a human face, I give him thumbs up. When Ebola hit Sierra Leone, the whole world reacted in a humanitarian way, sent us ambulances and medicines. When those medicines got to that country, the next step is how to get them to the rural poor. The roads are terrible, impassable. Had it not been for the availability of mobile phones communication, it would have been a worst disaster ever seen. How to tell our people as a stopgap to use salt, sugar, and water whilst awaiting the ORS, to use coconut water after the symptoms of vomiting and diarrhea the whole night. This was very, very serious for us. If those medicines through the telephone, we are not able to find a solution of that nature. That is why giving this ICT, a human face, is very, very important to us. ICT is very, very dear to Sierra Leone during the Ebola. Reporting the dead, reporting the symptoms in those remote places was very, very impossible. As a member of parliament, I represent a constituency. One of the quickest way I really mitigate the spread of Ebola in my constituency was the use of telephone. I made sure every village has a way of communicating through the mobile phone. That was the only quickest way. Because to get all those medicines from the international donations and to get, of course, the ambulances, very new ambulances, but they cannot get to those places because the roads are impassable. So I'm particularly happy that I am in this meeting, and I've seen a lot of people telling us about how important the ICT is. Sierra Leone is coming on as a member of the ITU. The government is working very hard. Of course, it has just been mentioned by the moderator about the conference that was recently held. I think I was one of those that attended that conference. I want to thank the government of Japan for recognizing Sierra Leone. And I believe I'm going to be an ambassador. All the information I have gotten here, my colleague also on my side is also a member of parliament in the opposition, and both of us have listened quite attentively, and we are going to be the ambassadors to take those messages to the rural poor because we represent constituencies. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that intervention. Thank you. So we have 20 minutes. I will need 5 minutes to summarize, so we have 15 minutes. If you try to keep your interventions short, it will be helpful because we can have more people speak. If you feel inspired, you can prepare a written statement. We have a link on the website for WTIS15. We will upload it so that you can share your perspectives freely. Is there anybody else or anyone else who wants to take the floor from the floor? Yes, please go ahead. If you could introduce yourself and then make your intervention.
Very good noon. My name is Mohammed Azizi, and I'm the chairman of the Regulatory Authority of Afghanistan. I think we discussed very important issues since morning. What's very important is that we have to find out a way in regards to the alignment of the SDGs and the ICT together. Because a lot of the time we talk about the importance of the two different teams, but at the same time it's very important that we do speak a bit more in detail on how we can align the role of ICT within the SDGs. And likewise, I would like to emphasize that it's very important that we do come up with indicators that will help us on one side to specify the role of the ICT in the SDGs, but then at the same time, we have to find the mechanisms of monitoring the progress in the achievement of the SDGs, in particular, the indicators that are from the that are the ICT relevant. And I think, lastly, what I want to say is that the role of data is very vital. And let's not take it only from the perspective of the merely using the word policy making. But I think if we want to develop the ecosystem of the electronic governance in our countries, if we want to really get into the innovation in the research and development, or even when we talk about the improved connectivity, I think for all these matters, data is very essential. And in today's world, in the digital world, I think big data needs to be an integral component for all of the countries if we are a small country or big country, we have to make ourselves ready for that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that intervention. Thank you. Yes, please. Bangladesh.
I am Sami Kobir from Bangladesh Bureau of Statistics, assistant programmer there. And actually, under the SDG 16, the accountable institution, so the open government data, OGD concept is being promoted by the UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs, UNDESA. So I'm wanting to know the view of actually Vice Minister from Thailand. So what steps has been taken so far by Thailand to promote the OGD, to make all the data, NSO, NRA, or any other agency, to make all the data coming in one single platform and make it easily accessible to the wider group of people? Thank you.
Thank you very much for that intervention. Is there anybody else the other side? Let's try to do a bit of gender balancing. I only hear very thick voices. Can we? My sister here represented many ladies, and that was very impressive. Can ladies also tell their stories? I will just pick one randomly. Okay. Yes, Brazil, please.
Thank you very much. Gender balance.
Yes.
Thank you very much. And I would actually like to draw on a subject that was raised by the representative of Malaysia. I'm from the Regional Center for the Development of the Information Society in Brazil. And I'd like to touch on the SDG number 5, which is actually achieving gender equality. And I'd like to hear from the representatives what efforts are needed to reduce the ICT gender gap and the role of national statistics in informing policymaking for this purpose. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I think I will do a one rounder to, is there anybody else who is asking for the floor? I don't see any. Great, so I will ask our panelists to try the 30-minute rule and see if they can answer quickly so that all of them can have a round if they wish. So there were two questions, one from Bangladesh, a comment that came from Afghanistan, and Brazil raised an issue on the issue of gender. And before you take the floor, so that you put your mind together, I see a hand up there. Please, go ahead.
Good morning to all. I'm Arvind Pandey. I'm from Ministry of Communication, Government of India. Regarding statistics, I have one question. There are 11 parameters in measuring the ICT index. So I feel that some certain of the parameters need to be relooked to see the actual ICT connectivity in the country. For example, there are some parameters on access, parameter on usage, and parameter on skills. So we need to actually really objectively see whether these parameters are how much they are relevant and how much they can be modified to see and to reflect the real ICT index. So, thank you.
Thank you very much for that intervention. I think we should acknowledge by as usual. Right. So allow me to respond to the last one. Just to let you know that we are a member-driven organization and we are proud of that. So you have a democratic right to comment, to propose, and to advance an argument. We have two groups that deal with statistics, stretching from data collection, processing, and reporting, the expert group on telecommunications indicators, and also the group on household indicators. There, you have two ways of contributing. One, you can go on the online platform and you can register yourself. If you are not registered and you wish to participate, see any one of our team member and you can register, and you are free there to make contributions and you will discuss with other experts. Then once a year, we have a meeting, 1 week meeting, where you can present and share your ideas, because as you understand, we have many countries, 193, we need to build some kind of consensus. But we are for improvement, we are for better reporting, we are for quality, and we would like to hear from you. And I think the Secretary General called that this morning in his opening remarks. So please feel free, but please join those two groups and contribute as much as you wish. But you raised a very important point. Let me move on to anyone from the panel. We have 5 minutes. If you wanted to say something, yes.
Gender balance. In the urban areas, we don't have much problems regarding the differences between men and women. But in the rural areas, the difference is very distinct. So what we are planning to do, we'll be setting up a fund, Innovators Fund, what we call Young Innovators Fund, because we've realized that we have the potential in youth especially. All we need is to create what they require to tease this potential into reality. So we are setting up the fund. We are drawing in businesses, and you know, just talking up, with them last week before I came here, a partnership between government and businesses so that businesses inject into this fund, and then we make these funds available to young people who will then create solutions. And one solution to address gender balance in the use of ICTs is to create appropriate ICT technology for these women, like appropriate mobile phones that they can use in the rural areas, imagining the environment in the rural areas where an African or Zimbabwean woman wants to do up her house using cow dung as they normally do, and the mobile phones dropped into the cow dung. She needs to take it up, wash it, and use it. And then on the cell phone, there is a prompt that she has been sent money by her daughter or her son in the UK. Then she rushes to a collection center and get the money. That kind of practical application to our environment. That's what we are trying to do.
Thank you very much for that. I would like to give the Deputy Prime Minister from Ethiopia to be also quite brief. Then I will move on to Malaysia, and I will conclude. Oh, okay, before I conclude, I will go this way. Okay, good. Fine. So please, let's be very, very brief, I beg you, because there is another program which will be commencing shortly, please.
Good. I just want to comment on 2 points that have been raised. Of course, they are very important points. This alignment of ICT and SDG, I think this is it should be the preoccupation of all of us, you know. And well, two goals definitely have been specifically addressed, you know, ICT, as you just mentioned, about gender, as well as infrastructure and social inclusion. So that speaks by its own a lot about ICT. But all the targets definitely should be aligned with ICT, and this is homework for ITU and for all of us to do. I think there are a lot of exercises that should have made. So we have to integrate all these ICTs with all the targets and the goals that have been mentioned, specifically in all our development agendas of the countries. Regarding gender, this ICT issue, it's also part of it, but I feel that this ICT gender must base mainly on, you know, other development agendas. There must be a gender balance on education. It has to start with education. If there is imbalance on education, you just cannot balance it on ICT. It's not about distributing, you know, an apparatus. You just cannot secure and cannot confirm that there will be a gender balance. If gender balance has to be first address education, health, poverty alleviation, and ICT can be an instrument for that too. So I think we have to combine with a major interventionist to address the gender balance. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me go to Malaysia, but before I do that, I will come back to okay. You are not asking for the floor. Very good. Are you asking or not?
I am.
Okay, very good. So, very good again. Okay. So just to let you, thank you very much. You raised a very important point. That ITU is in the forefront, in fact. Since the times of the MDGs, ITU has been in the forefront working with other UN agencies through a framework that we call the partnership. And we are developing indicators including those for the Sustainable Development Goals. And we agree with you fully that we have to map those indicators, because we are in a world of indicators for indicators. So the SDGs, and we also follow the WISIS, the World Summit on the Information Society, which has got also its own part. So we have to make sure that there is some kind of convergence and coherence in that area. But Malaysia, please, on gender.
Thank you. I just would like to discuss a little bit more on the gender balance, or I call it gender equality. I think, Mr. Moderator, it is always good to begin in this context that we are discussing today. It's about indicators, about the role of the statisticians, role of the data collectors. That data collectors and statisticians cannot be at the peripheral of gender issues. Mm-hmm. They must be at the center stage, because it is very important for them, like a journalist, to know what are the gender issues all about. If they do not know, then they cannot create that kind of ecosystem where you can spur gender equality. That is one. Second one is about to make sure that actually whatever that is happening around us here today, we must make sure that we go back and implement it. It cannot just be discussing here. And make sure that all countries will have to begin with, if you have not already done so, gender sensitization program, gender budgeting, gender mainstreaming. It's no more integration of gender issues into the policy making. It is the mainstreaming part that is very, very important. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you very much, and you were brief. So I recognize the Minister of Guinea-Bissau.
Well, thank you, Moderator. I'm not going to talk about gender because I think a lot has been said and been said well. I just have a general comment. And after everything that was said, the question for a least developed country like Guinea-Bissau is what's next? And I think it should be interesting for us, and probably is a challenge for the audience to see how the audience, mainly the researchers, to see how we're going to make sure that we as an organization, we can work together in order to make a sort of developed countries working with least developed countries to reduce this digital divide. I think that this is one of the questions that we haven't probably put forward, to see ways in which you could strengthen our cooperation. For instance, how can Guinea-Bissau benefit from the experience of Japan? I think these are issues that probably researchers could help us to find ways in which we could improve it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for that comment. Let me invite the Minister of Zambia to say a few words.
Thank you, sir. First and foremost, I would like to say that with the Zambian government on issues of gender, we have specifically created a ministry, which is a ministry of gender, which is mainstreaming most of the gender activities. Hence, the issue of budgeting has been addressed from that angle, because the Ministry of Gender gets a budget from the national budget. That's what I can say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Vice Minister Japan, please.
Thank you very much, Moderator. And as you know, many statistics were made in the industrial age, not information age. We want to build the new statistic in the information age. And we can physical data, we can collect physical data easily, but information data is difficult. And however, several countries have best practices to exchange best practices. Therefore, the role of WTIS is important. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can we thank all the ministers for their active participation and for their invaluable ideas? So let me do a quick summary. Before I close, for the purpose of the report, you are going to have a report for this session, and it is going to be integrated into the main report of this event. And my colleagues are taking note of the report, and I would like to conclude as follows. We, the policymakers, sitting here in Hiroshima on this date have agreed on the following. One, to increase clarity on all issues pertaining to data collection, data processing, and ICT in general. Second, to make sure that we optimize the use of all those resources that are at our disposal for purposes of reducing deaths when disasters do strike, but also for contributing to sustainable development by making sure that we grow economies. Second, making sure that we all at our level as policymakers promote gender issues by focusing on inclusivity, and that brings also the people with the challenges, physical challenges, people with the disabilities. That we shall use ICTs to mitigate the impact of climate change and help countries to adapt. That we shall innovate continuously, and innovate not only in introducing new, appropriate, affordable technologies, but also in terms of data collection as we move from the industrial age to the information age. Capacity building has been recognized as one of those key drivers, and the director of the BDT has committed to run capacity building events for policymakers. And I think we are lucky to have members of parliament who are lobbied when public policies are being formulated. We are lucky to have the ministers that are responsible for ensuring the implementation. We are lucky to have experts who are dealing with the statistics. But the next point being that we have to embrace new technologies as they do emerge. That goes to the issue of big data. The Deputy Minister of Tonga said small data for small countries. But we are integrated into the international community, so small plus small, we have big. So big data. So innovation has been repeatedly mentioned by all, and we have to make sure that we embrace machine-to-machine communications, because our statistics indicate that today there are over 25 billion devices talking to each other. By 2020, it is estimated that 45 billion devices will be talking to each other. And how can we capture the data that comes out of all those sensors that we have at our disposal? Big data for better decision making and better impact. I think that is very important. The final point being that we, the policymakers sitting today, have committed to go beyond talking and to make sure that we implement those decisions that we are making and undertake that next year when a WTIS sits, that we'll be reviewing the progress that we would have made. Until then, I thank you very much for your participation, including the audience. Thank you very much.
Excellencies, Deputy Prime Ministers and the Ministers, thank you very much. It was a lively discussion, and we were enlightened the thoughtful ideas and the comments by each panelist. Thank you, Dr. Zawazawa, for fine moderatorship. Once again, let's applaud the participants on the stage. So before ending, I have three announcements. Number one, WTIS 15 quiz. All of you already got the one page of quiz. It will take just 2 minutes. Please refill it and leave it at the registration office. ITU and Japanese government will make a good present for the winners. The announcement of the winner will be announced will be done as a reception tonight. So please never fail to register it. This is number one. Number two, those excellencies who participated in this ministerial roundtable and who will participate in the leaders' dialogue and all the other registered VIPs by the ITU, are invited to the VIP lunch from now on. This is the second point. And the third point, other guests will be invited to the buffet lunch at the hall next to this meeting venue. Today's concept of buffet lunch is vegetables and mainly Japanese. The concept of tomorrow buffet lunch is vegetables and mainly Western. On the third day, the concept of the buffet lunch is vegetables and mainly Chinese. So please don't miss each of the buffet lunch. All right, so VIPs will leave the room firstly. So, before that, yes, photo time, sorry.
Yeah, let's.
So Mr. Yasuo Sakamoto, Vice Minister of our ministry, will escort all of the VIPs to the venue of the VIP lunch. So please follow Vice Minister Mr. Sakamoto. And after the VIP lunch, the briefing for the next leaders dialogue will be done at the same place of the VIP lunch. So those people who will participate in the leaders' dialogue, please follow Mr. Sakamoto also. All right.